شو علوم القرآن؟ علوم القرآن طيب In علوم القرآن, if you look at the النظم الحبير, we are at the بيت 105. And 105 is starting جمع القرآن, the collection and the compilation of the Quran. So I will read, and this is what we have done last time, and then to continue from here. وأشهر الجمع على التحقيق في عصر ذا الخليفة الصديق مسميا بالمصحف الشهير من دون منكر ولا نكير وبعده عثمان يا رشيد ونسخه لحرفه جديد لقول ناصح بلا توان حذيفة ابن ذلك اليمن. We mentioned that. So the first compilation done in the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala an, by the advice and recommendation of Umar, and then you know that Zayd ibn Thabit, he took the lead to do such a great effort. And then after that, with the advice of Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, came to advise Uthman, and Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an, he did something unique and great in the history of Islam, which is to recheck again the Mus'haf of Abu Bakr, which was at that time in the hand of Umm al-Mu'minina, Hafsa, and he called Zayd ibn Thabit, who also led the committee again, to reconstruct exactly how it was done the first time, the first compilation, with the same condition. And then for this time, they had more caring about another aspect. The second aspect is how to include the more qira'at in the mushaf. So to do such a thing, they intentionally didn't put the dots on the letter and the shekel, and the shekel, and the shekel, which is harakatul huruf. For example, when you say, when you write, for example, mithqal, you can read it mithqalu, mithqala, mithqali. So the haraka is either fatha or dhamma or kasra. If you don't put the haraka, you're going to read it based on the siyaq, based on the place of the mithqal in the sentence. And in the Quran, the siyaq, the way of the reading can change. It's either you can, that particular word started as a beginning of a sentence, or you can use it as part of the sentence, but not in the beginning of the sentence. So, because different qira'at, I give you the example. In I had Mus'haf Qalun. I give you some example. قال في سورة النبأ قالوا لا يسمعون فيها لغوا ولا كذاب جزاء من ربك عطاء حساب. Then ربي, right, ربي السماوات والأرض. طيب إن قراءتنا فيقول رب السماوات والأرض instead of ربي. فهنا ربي على الكسر is continuation of مضاف of the first sentence جزاء من ربك from your lord من ربك. And who is ربك؟ رب السماوات والأرض. Now when you say جزاء من ربك عطاء حسابا full stop and then you start مبتدأ رب السماوات والأرض. This ربي ورب it complement the meaning and different when you read them. Different not in the words but it enrich the meaning. So in one, when you write رب بدون الحركة without putting ضمة or كسرة, so you include two قراءات in the same writing. واضح. And then when you don't put the dots, the same thing, you include more than a قراءة. Like I gave you the example last time, ينشرها وينشزها ينشرها وينشزها totally different word. But if you write them without the dust, they look the same. So the second jama was have this focus on including the maximum possible of qira'at by intentionally not putting the dots and not putting the harakat. Then is going to have the qira'at going through by recitation. Let me read for you the mulakhas, a summary of both compilation from the book of said by Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah in his fatwa. يقول فلما كان العام الذي قبض فيه when it was the year in which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم passed away عارضه جبريل به عارضه جبريل به جبريل he came and he had the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to recite the whole Quran to him two times he did it he recited two times in Ramadan last year. والعرضة الأخيرة هي قراءة زيد ابن ثابت وغيره. This last recitation of the Prophet, it was what زيد ابن ثابت was teaching and reciting. That's why Abu Bakr and Umar called زيد ابن ثابت. Because there's قراءة slightly different of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. That some people they say, oh, there's Qurra, they've been teaching the Qira of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud long after the time of the Jama'ah. Therefore, you have more than a Mus'haf. We said no. That's a fake allegation. قال, they called them Qira to Zayd ibn Thabit wa ghayri. وهي التي أمر الخلفاء الراشدون أبو بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي بكتابتها في المصاحف. And that particular قراءة which was the last full complete recitation by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم on Jibreel in the last year of his life, that's the one that the four guided khalifas they commanded to be written in the books. مصاحف. ثم أمر عثمان في خلافته بكتابتها في المصاحف. Then عثمان رضي الله تعالى عنه in his time he ordered to be written in the مصحف. وإرسالها إلى الأمصار باتفاق من الصحابة. and to send it to all around the Muslim world by the consensus of the companion. And we said it was unique and great action to preserve the Book of Allah. If you have the original copy, and then all the companion, they witness its writing. And you remember we said every piece added to this writing was being, you know, has two witnesses who witnessed, to include one writing, anyone who has a part of the Quran from the writer of the Wahi, that he has two witnesses that they witnessed that he wrote that in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, there's this allegation, you know, that they said the different qira'at is a result of mistakes of the writer of the Wahy. There's people, they try to find, a way to get to the Qur'an. Say that was not, because these people, when they do such a thing, they don't have a full scope of the sciences of the Quran and a full scope of the language of the Arabs at that time. Because when you say ضعفاً أو ضعفة, or you say, you know, the different language that they say, is the same thing in the language, the same thing. Some of the words that mean more tafsir by the companion and not as taught by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So therefore, they will not be part of the Quran. That's what we call qira'atun shadda. Now, when you bring it all in one book, Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he copied that book. And he burned everything else. So to have the mother book that is being written by double committee in time of Abu Bakr, then in time of Uthman, with the same one who was leading the committee of the compilation of the Quran in the time of Abu Bakr, who is Zayd ibn Thabit, plus the three young and skilled one from Quraysh. So they will be always checking the language which is the closest to the language of the Prophet, to the mother tongue of the Prophet. So here, even among the Arabs, we have the priority to the mother tongue of the Prophet, which it was the slang of Quraysh, the sound of the Arabic language from Quraysh. Now that you have this book, what do you need the other books all around there, outside? Those, in a time of fitna, they might be a source of a big fitna. Because every book out there from some companion, not only they have the Quran, they have their remark, their observation, their comment, footnotes. If you take that footnotes, like it happened in previous book, those footnotes become part of the body of the book. So how to get rid of such thing, not on that time, but how to block and avoid a fitna that you presume that it might happen, is to burn everything else. That's how you eradicate the, let's say, the roots of any fitna that might come. So anyone else, as till today, they coming up with this allegation, subhanAllah, every Muslim, he feel like so that certitude that is being already done. No one can infiltrate the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it's double checked at every moment, which is from the recitation and from the writing and reading. Okay. The author of Al-Nudum Al-Habir, he said, after that, he started to talk about Al-Ahruf Al-Saba, the seven letters. But before to get to the Ahruf Al-Saba, in 5 minutes, I'll give you, inshallah, we'll take the break, 7:15, And then you'll have time, I think the Maghrib at 7:35. And then we'll meet back after Maghrib, inshallah. So in 5 minutes, in 4 minutes, he'll give you the time. Before get to that, how many mushaf in time of Uthman they had copied? هنا يقول في كتاب البداية والنهاية لابن كثير المشهور أنها 5 مصاحف 5 مصاحف. عثمان رضي الله تعالى عنه send this 5 to مكة، الشام، البصرة، الكوفة، and one stayed in المدينة. And there's another narration who's saying there were 7. And even when there were 7, there's kind of difference of narration concerning to which country they were sent, this second, the 2 others. He said some of them, they say Ahlu Masr. And وبعث إلى البصرة مصحفا وإلى الكوفة بآخر وأرسل إلى الشام مصحفا وإلى اليمن. And he sent to Yemen, so the 2 other countries, Egypt, Masr, and Al-Yemen. In another book, which is أورده ابن أبي داود in his book المصاحف, saying that ذكر أبو شامة. And also Abu Shama mentioned it in his book Al-Murshid. And As-Suyuti, as you have, if you go back and recite in Al-Itqan, you'll find it also. قال أن عثمان رضي الله عنه وجه بسبعة مصاحف. Uthman, he sent 7 masahif. The 5 that we mentioned, Mecca, Al-Sham, Al-Basra, Wal-Kufa, Wal-Madinah. وأرسل مصحفا إلى اليمن ومصحفا إلى البحرين. One to Yemen and one البحرين. So if there are 7, we have 2 saying in the 2 after the 5. Yemen and Egypt or Yemen and Bahrain. But and he continued, Abu Shama and As-Suyuti said, we didn't hear anything about these 2 last mushaf. Which coming back, the well-known and the certain ones, they are the 5 masahif. And Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an, he didn't send simply the mushaf. He sent with every mushaf an imam of qira'ah. So the imams of qira'ah, from them, subhanAllah, derive all the qira'at today. And these masahif, they call the masahif imam. Imam, the leaders, the main, the first ones. So, remember what we said. We said Mecca, Medina, Mecca, Sham, Al-Basra, Al-Kufa, right? Then, you'll find the Qurra in Medina, that the Qira'at today, we find them, they are originally from Medina, Mecca, Al-Basra, Al-Sham, Al-Kufa. The qira'a that we study today, and most of the people they recite, is Asim, right? Qira'a to Asim. So Hafs an Asim. Asim from where? From Al-Kufa. Qalun wa Warsh from where? From Nafa, from Medina. Ibn Kathir from where? From Mecca. Ibn Amr from where? From Al-Sham. Abu Amr al-Basri from where? From Al-Basra. أبو عمر ابن علاء البصري عبد الله ابن كثير المكي نافع ابن عبد الرحمن المدني عبد الله ابن عامر الشامي وعاصم وحمزة وعلي ابن حمزة الكسائي وابن حبيب الزيات all of them from الكوفة which is سبحان الله the five مصاحف with the five حفاظ مقرئين They had, subhanAllah, to have student after student, and it goes. And then when Ibn Mujahid came, he came from like not choosing all this like randomly, but he chose them because they have a line going back to the Masahif al-Umm. It's like full structured, well-connected network. MashaAllah. I'll give you, I took from your break 2 minutes. You can compensate it after Maghrib, inshallah. Jazakum Allah khair. We'll meet you after Salat al Maghrib. Inshallah. طيب. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه أما بعد. Inshallah, after finishing the collection and the compilation of the Quran, both of them studied in the time of Abu Bakr and the time of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And alhamdulillah, the great unique action of Uthman to preserve the book of Allah by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who promised to preserve his book. Inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Do you have any question concerning the compilation of Uthman? As I said, subhanAllah, I mean, is there going to be always people talking about the Qur'an? وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَا تَسْمَعُوا لِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ وَالْغَوْ فِيهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَغْلِبُونَ لم يقولوا قولوا فيه معناها لم يقولوا that he didn't say وأجد فيه من التناقض find what he has contradiction قال والغو فيه اللغو say any talk any vain talk just to spread doubt and this is gonna be normal ف as you see كتاب ابن مجاهد and then when it come الكتاب of الجزري and the متن of الشاطبية all of it is based On the Qurra, that Qurra, as I said, are not random Qurra. All the Qurra, that they've been very well known in their time. They lived, mashallah, long life, which is mean they have a very big number of students. And the type of the education at the time, it was people, they traveled to this Qurra to learn from them. And some of the students, they stay, you know, they you know, Not only they recite one time, it's like a dozen or like, you know, some of them, you know, hundreds of times. These Qurra are known, imagine, you know, today, the very well skilled, you find them in certain subjects, you know, that they've been, for example, teaching the same subject for 10 years, 20 years, for example, at the university. So it becomes expert in that particular book. Imagine someone teaching it, for example, teaching science of Quran, the same book for 10 years. He knows every part of this book. So imagine someone teaching Quran. Last time I was talking to our Sheikh, Sheikh Walid, Hafizahullah. They said they have in Medina one of the Qurra reciter. They said in Masjid al-Nabawi, they had his first ijazah that he signed and the last one before he died in the Masjid Nabawi, between them, between these two dates, almost 70 years. So imagine being sitting for the all this time teaching, you know. This is, subhanAllah, is blessing. So imagine these scholars, they've been teaching for long years. And they get from the scholar a like, Qurra, and go back to the Qurra that been sent by Uthman with the Mus'haf. So the Qurra that been sent from Uthman with the Mus'haf, they are from the Kibar al-Tabi'een. They learn the Qur'an from the companion. And they have the book, which is, you know, a kind of copy and conform of what they memorize. And they've been teaching for all these years. So when you come to the Qur'an that we have today, it's part of a very well, you know, structured network of Qira'at going back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. الأحرف السبعة. الأحرف السبعة is the next chapter. Of course, the evidence of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم reciting the Quran twice in his last years is in Sahih al-Bukhari. In Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, متفق عليه. يرحمكم الله. And also in Musnad Ahmad, and he's mentioned in Riyadh al-Salihin, وابن ماجه والدارمي. And actually the hadith narrated by Aisha on behalf of Sayyida Fatima رضي الله تعالى عنها. Okay, so that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he told her before he died, he said from among the thing he said to Fatima, and Fatima, she narrated the hadith after the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, that he said, Jibreel, he used to come and review the Quran with me every year. And the last one, this last time, I recited twice the complete Quran. That was, subhanAllah, the preparation of the departure of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Al-Hadith al-Ahruf al-Sabah. حديث الأحرف السبع from النظم الحبير قال, and this is we talking about at the verse البيت 109. روى البخاري مسندا ومسلم دليل من يقول وهو يعلم بأن في القرآن للمستعرف لسبعة موسومة بالأحرف. Was that narrated in Bukhari and Musnad with evidence to have this knowledge that in the Quran there's these seven letters, seven ahruf. Let's say ahruf, because if we say letter, we're going given the wrong translation, because ahruf is a letter, harfun is a letter, but this is not the meaning of it. لِسَبْعَةٍ مَوْسُومَةً بِالْأَحْرُفِ وَقَدْ حَكَى أَبُو عُبَيْدٍ نَاشِرًا بِأَنَّهَا بَالِغَةٌ تَوَاتِرًا. أبو عبيد, you know, in his book he said, قال هو القاسم ابن السلام المشهور, one of the greatest قراء. He said, this is سبع أحرف is متواترة. What is this سبع أحرف? The hadith that he mentioned, أخرجه البخاري ومسلم عن عمر ابن الخطاب. قال حديث الأحرف السبع first, قال تواتر عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, as he mentioned here. قال هنا في لسبعة بأنها 111, بأنها بالغة تواترة. And you know the meaning of the تواتر, we study it in the حديث, in the مصطلح الحديث. And when we say تواتر is when we have the certainty of its origin to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, full certitude. like the Quran. وألف فيه كثير من العلماء رسائل خاصة وممن ألف في الحديث المذكور الإمام الحافظ أبو شامة وابن الجزري الذي ألف فيه جزءا عن الحديث عن أحرف السبع. So one of the great scholars, they wrote books specifically for the hadith of the seven أحرف. The hadith that I mentioned, inshallah, قال ونص الحديث ونص الحديث the hadith as been mentioned in البخاري ومسلم عن عمر بن الخطاب قال سمعت هشام بن حكم سمعت هشام بن حكم يقرأ سورة الفرقان. I heard عمر بن الخطاب saying, he said, I was listening someone reading Quran. It was Hisham ibn Hakam. He was reciting Surah Al-Furqan. في حياة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. When the Prophet was alive. فاستمعت لقراءته فإذا هو يقرأها على حروف كثيرة لم يقرئنيها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Look, أحرف. So this is have we kind of closed meaning of the meaning of the أحرف. I heard Hisham ibn Hakim, he reciting Surah Al-Furqan on different notes, on different ways than the way that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam taught me. So Ahraf, subhanAllah, when you listen, is the same meaning, is the same rhyme, but there's things are different. It's like you recognize, you know that it's Surah Al-Furqan. You know all the ayat, but the tongue kind of changing, not the way that I usually recite it. This is what Umar is saying. For example, أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. He might heard أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. Things like that. وَجَعَلْنَا الْأَرْضَ فِرَاشًا. He heard it, فِرَاشًا. This sound change, that what he draw his attention. قال فكدت أساوره فكدت أساوره. He said, I was about to jump on him. I mean, he's reading the Quran wrong. فإذا هو يقرأها على حروف فكدت في الصلاة. He was praying, I was about to jump on him and stop him. فانتظرته حتى سلم. I waited him till he finished the prayer. ثم لببته بردائه. You know, عمر. قال لببته. I hold him from his clothes, like, you know. قال لببته. أي جمعت الرداء في موضع لبته أي عنقه. He's almost strangling him. فقلت من أقرأك هذه السورة. I told him, who the one who taught you this surah, the way you recite it. فقال أقرأنيها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Said the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم taught me this one. قلت له كذبت. Say you're lying. Because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم taught me the same surah, different the way that you say it. فوالله إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أقرأني هذه السورة التي سمعتك تقرأها. فانطلقت أقوده إلى رسول الله. He was holding him, taking him to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. We have a big problem. He's reciting a surah not the way that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم taught me. فقلت يا رسول الله إني سمعت هذا يقرأ بسورة الفرقان على حروف لم تقرئنيها. I heard him recite Surah Al-Furqan with some of the letters, with some of the harakat, with some of the differences that you didn't teach me, يا رسول الله. وأنت أقرأتني سورة الفرقان. And you who taught me سورة الفرقان. So I don't have doubt that he's mistaken. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أرسله يا عمر. I mean أرسله because he was holding him. So he said leave him first. قال اقرأ يا هشام. Read يا هشام. قال فقرأ هذه القراءة التي سمعته يقرأها. So he recited exactly the recitation that I heard, that I was opposing, that I make me, you know, stopping him, and that's why I brought him to the Prophet. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم هكذا أنزلت. This is how it was revealed. ثم قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن إن هذا القرآن أنزل على سبعة أحرف فقرأوا ما تيسر منه. This Quran was revealed on seven أحرف. Read whatever is easy for you and convenient to read from any أحرف. طيب. وأخرج مسلم عن أبي بن كعب أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان عند أضات ابن غفار كان عند أضات ابن غفار أضات بني غفار كان عند وعند أضات بني غفار is like kind of pond of بني غفار فأتاه جبريل عليه السلام جبريل came to him فقال إن الله يأمرك أن تقرئ أمتك القرآن على حرف Allah is ordering you to teach your ummah the Quran on one حرف فقال أسأل الله معافاته ومغفرته وإن أمتي لا تطيق ذلك I ask Allah his forgiveness and his forbearing and his عفو My ummah will not handle one harf. ثم أتاه الثانية فقال إن الله يأمرك أن تقرأ أمتك القرآن على حرفي. So Jibreel came back. He told him Allah سبحانه وتعالى said, command you to teach your ummah the Quran on two harf. فقال أسأل الله معافاته ومغفرته. I'll ask Allah his forgiveness and his معافات and his forbearing. My ummah will not handle the two. ثم جاءه الثالثة فقال إن الله يأمرك أن تقرأ أمتك القرآن على ثلاثة أحرف. So Jibreel came back from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to say to the Prophet, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling you to teach them on three أحرف. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم again he said, it's not, my ummah will not handle it. ثم جاء الرابعة then the fourth time فقال إن الله يأمرك in the fourth time he said إن الله يأمرك أن تقرأ أمتك القرآن على سبعة أحرف فأيما حرف قرأوا عليه فقد أصاب whatever note or حرف they read on it there will be فقد أصابوا that will be the right words of Allah سبحانه وتعالى Here, when we say harf and sab'ati ahraf, there's first the ahraf of sab'a, nothing have to do with the qira'at. The seven qira'at, which is now, you know, the most famous are 10. So, what are the ahraf of sab'a? Ahraf of sab'a, the most simple definition of it is the language, the different language among the Arabs. And we're going to say Ibn Mujahid, as Ibn al-Jazari mentioned, to see what are the differences. قال ومن الجدير بالذكر التنبيه إلى أن السبع هنا يراد بها مدلولها الرقمي. ولولا التدرج الوارد في هذا الحديث لما كان هناك مانع من أن يكون قد أريد بها التعدد. So the seven is not exactly seven, but the seven is like many. As the Arabs sometimes they use that. لأن من عادة العرب أن تستعمل السبعة لتدل على التعدد في الأحاد. سبعة is like more in the أحاد. والسبعين في العشرات وسبعمائة في المئات. So it's like it's more than one قراءة. ومن حرف. I'm sorry. More than one حرف. طيب. سبع أحرف قد ذهب ابن جرير وغيره فقالوا إن القراءة على الأحرف السبع يراد بها سبع لغات seven language seven language from the language of the Arabs المشهورة في كلمة واحدة ومعنى واحد، أي أوجه من الألفاظ المختلفة في كلمة واحدة ومعنى واحد. Find one word, it had the same meaning, but it pronounced it in different way. Pronounced in different way. نحو هلم وأقبل وتعالى وعجل وأسرع. All of them, they have the same thing. هلم, come, أقبل, come, تعالى, come. So these words are different language, but they mean the same thing. وقد حكى هذا القول ابن تيمية في الفتاوى. Now, one of the subtle things in the قراءات, in the أحرف السبعة, is Allah's rahmah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this ummah. Because if the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show his mercy when he revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to teach the ummah the Quran on one harf, let's say on one language, on one sound, you know what it means? Anyone who will read in any of that sound, he will be punished and he will be sinful. Because this is the Quran. Instead of saying Maliki, you say Maliki. Maliki is sin. It's not Maliki 30 Hasana. So that's why the Prophet said, my Ummah cannot handle it. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his Rahmah, make it to be seven, so to have all the Arab to come, subhanAllah, to feel that language and to be easy for them to recite it. It's like, for example, someone, a king who wrote a letter, a note, a communique for the for his people. Yeah? He said they have to copy it and have read it exactly as it's been written. And then anyone who gonna make a mistake is like he's doing, sending the wrong message. Imagine the stress and the difficulty that everyone who's gonna convey the message. So the thing is gonna be how to be really fulfilling that same reading or saying the same words. So when you're talking about the Quran, it's gonna be more difficult. Because they're gonna be new people coming to Islam. And then at that time they'll have, you know, people who you want to gain their hearts. So if you tell them you only can read on the note of the language of Quraysh, then people, they will not be easy for them who get used it with this different slang to correct their tongue so they will not be sinful. You understand how important. Now, if you have every word in the Quran have up to seven ways to be read, then if you make the combination of the whole words of the Quran with a probability of seven options to be read, so you have a very simple ways to have everybody easy for them to read the Quran. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّنَّ الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرٍ. واضح. طيب. قال ومن هؤلاء إن الترخيص في الأحرف السبعة كان في أول الإسلام لما في المحافظة على حرف واحد من المشق. So some of the scholars, they said the seven letters was in the beginning of the Islam because to have one language for everyone to unite around it is going to be very difficult. And then, subhanAllah, look, Allah's will and gift on the Ummah. The majority of the Ummah now they read with only one qira, one qira, one note. So when it was many, usually in history, everything that starts with one, it ends with many. You have one note, when people they copy it, it end up after a few centuries to be like, you know, different version. The Quran started with different version in rhymes, not in the meaning or in the words, in the way you listen to it, the way it rhymes, the notes. It ends to be subhanAllah almost one. And that's the miracle of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Instead of, you know, with the natural things, if it wasn't from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you'll have more and more, more, and you, instead of people reciting one recitation, you have, everyone has his own recitation. Tayyib. I want to tell you what are exactly these different differences in the Ahruf Saba, or what we mean about Ahruf Saba. Yes, yes. Yeah, please, if you, I'll show you where to find. Huh? 183. Okay, open the 183, because there's one conclusion that I want to study it with you. What chapter, the number of the chapter? Okay. Type, let me find it here, because I know I have it here. Huh? Tayyib, please, I mean, review it, but I have it here to what we already have said. The Ahruf Saba, as we said, are the seven language, right? But when we say seven language, some of the scholar, they put them, what are the differences in the seven language that we can see in the book, in the Quran? So he's saying, قَالَ الحروف السبعة التي أخبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن القرآن نزل عليها تجري على ضربين. It has two categories. أحدهما زيادة كلمة ونقص أخرى. So you add a word or you a less word. So that's one in the language itself. وإبدال كلمة مكان أخرى. Or to change a word by another word. And both of them completing the meaning, like maliki, maliki, yunshiruha, yunshizuha, yusayyurukum, yunshirukum. Change word by word, are they complete the meaning? قال وتقديم كلمة على الأخرى. And to have a kalima being, you know, is either you put it after one kalima or you advance it. So this is one type of the language itself, which is to reduce one word or to add one word, or to ibdal kalima makan ukhra, to change the word by a synonym or another word that is fit the same meaning, as we mentioned, maliki and maliki, king and owner, and to advance a word or to delay it. وَذَلِكَ نَحْوُ مَا رَوَى فَهَذَا الضرب وما أشبه متروك إلى آخره. قال والضرب الثاني ما اختلف القراء فيه. Okay. Now, this part, which is very important, when talking about these, they've been kind of removed. How can be removed? Because as the Mus'haf of Uthman settled for us all the words that they are, you know, retained by the Ijma' al-Sahab. If there's a qira'ah before Mus'haf Uthman, when, for example, قال وكان وراءهم ملك يأخذ كل سفينة غصب وكان أمامهم ملك وراءهم من أمامهم and there's ahead of them وراءهم أمامهم is the same ملك يأخذ كل سفينة غصب there's another قراءة كل سفينة صالحة غصبة that he takes and there's a king ahead of them any boat that pass by he will take it the other قراءة any boat that is sound I mean does not have any defect صالحة he take it all these things that you put change word by word or add word has been those type of qira'at that stopped at the time of the companion. Okay, why? Because the consensus of the Sahaba, they are around the book of Uthman. When we say book of Uthman, he didn't write it. The whole companion, the one Allah Ta'ala alayhim, by the committee that we have mentioned. Because many people, when they want to delude people, they said, is it written by Uthman? He didn't write it. He's in time of Uthman. And he's the one who orders, radiallahu ta'ala. What stayed as different language, what stayed after different language in the Mus'haf that we have, قال, what the Qur'an, they have different in their pronunciation, like, al-idhharu, al-idghamu, al-rawmu, al-ishmamu, القصر المد التخفيف الشد وإبدال الحركة بأخرى. So those are the لغات. So when you said إظهار حكم الإظهار, for example, عذابا أليما. Other they say عذابا أليما. You know نقل. So this نقل is two language, but it's the same words. When you read it, when you write it the same. So the difference, the idgham, may yaf'al. There's a call, may yaf'al, without ghunna. There's the idgham, al-kabir, in some billam. There's idgham, for example, bi ghunna, in, for example, in hafs, that we don't do the ghunna in it. So all these differences in the way of pronunciation, in the way of recitation, that's the different ahraf, okay? So qal, for example, idhar, إدغام روم إشمام الإشمام for example الصاد الصاد in some قراءة when you add the إشمام the pronunciation of it kind of زي instead of saying إهدنا الصراط المستقيم say إهدنا الصراط المستقيم and those are language of the Arabic language for example there is the way قال وأتوا حقه يوم حصاده and known is Arabic language is a language that is named حصاد not حصاد in the day of his harvest so there's قراءة they use حصاد قال ولا تدخلوا بيوتا and لا تدخلوا بيوتا النبي بيوتا there's بيوتا there's a language say instead of say بيوت they say بيوت So all of these different language, but the same words. So that's the differences, okay? إبدال حركة بأخرى. فهذا الضرب هو المستعمل في زمن. So this part of إدغام, of إظهار, of مد. You know, some, for example, لمن شاء. The other one, is لمن شاء. This is two language, but it's the same word. واضح. نعم.
كثيرة وكبيرة.
Yeah, you see, كثيرة وكبيرة. When you write them without dots, it's the same. صح ولا لا؟ Write them without dot. كبيرة كثيرة. For someone, a student, you know, the shuyukh, they give the matan to one of the students to read, and the sheikh, he'll explain. So the student who usually read is not there. There's a new student, he say, he give it to him to read. He said, read, son, read. So he start to read, and then there's no dots. He said, قال عن شختي عن بختي عن شفتان البوري. قالوا, what? شختي بختي شفتان البوري. أو عن شتخي بختي شفتان البوري. So he told him, give me, give me. He told him, قالوا عن شيخي عن يحيى عن سفيان الثوري. Voilà. So someone who, I mean, he was speaking gibberish. طيب. فثبت بهذا أن هذه القراءات التي نقرأها هي بعض من الحروف السبع. So the قراءات that we have today is a part of the seven أحرف that been revealed to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now, the most important here to say these differences into the pronunciation in some of the words, its objective is to make it easy for the followers of the way of Allah in the beginning to embrace the Quran, to have the Quran easy for them. And also, subhanAllah, to soften the heart to Islam. Because a tribe, when they hear the Quran from Allah using one of their words, which is specific to their tribe, they make them love the Quran. And it was wisdom subhanahu from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring the hearts together. The hearts together. At all. Yes. 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 I have in like I have a note where one of the book he mentioned they mentioned exactly the seven ahruf by some of the scholars early scholars to define them, and that's what I was trying to find for you. طيب. Which page? 108. Yeah, they said seven language, or they called dialects. Yeah. طيب إن شاء الله next week بإذن الله تعالى I will find the hadith and I will bring it to you because I thought I have it here where it defined exactly the seven أحرف and it's good for the student of knowledge to have them. It's been mentioned of the early books and many of the scholars subhanAllah they have it. I mean they mention it, which is طيب خير إن شاء الله. So we stop here and we try to do some of التحفة العراقية إن شاء الله تعالى.